Huzzah, Rangers. This is Phil Harris again here at the Jack's Rangers Show. I am joined with my buddy here. We must shop at the same place with these hats here, Dave. Dave McVeigh is with me. How are you?
I'm doing well. Excellent sense of style, Phil.
Oh, yeah. Always, always. Let's talk about our little brothers down there in New Jersey. We've got the preview here for the game against New Jersey at Fort Quincy, the last regular season game in the entire season. It's crazy how fast it's gone by, but we're at the end of the regular season. Both of these teams have qualified for the postseason, which is an interesting thing to note. I'll get right into my little preview thoughts here. New Jersey finds themselves in third spot in the Eastern Conference standings with 52 points. The Old Blacks are tied on points with Atlanta heading into the last game of the regular season. They have earned a playoff spot in the postseason. I expected this team to be towards the top of the table in the preseason, that is. 10 wins and 4 losses with 412. 12 points for, and the points against 394, which is a point differential of plus 52, which is actually seems kind of low when you think about it. This is a team that's qualified for the playoffs. I'd expect that to be higher. This is a team that has been dominated by their rivals, which is our Free Jacks, since the beginning. I think New Jersey has won one game of this rival, and we've won 4 at this point, I believe that is. They have made a splash, and they kind of had to. Because they saw a dip in form, you know, towards the end of the season. So they had to, you know, hey, it's New York. Hey, we got to have some big, you know, big name signings here. It's a big market or whatever they would say. So they've brought in some, and some people think this is, you know, kind of bending the rules a little bit for MLR. So I'm going to say it's a controversial signings of New Zealand All Blacks that are World Cup winners from the 2015 World Cup there in England. Dave, what do you make of this New Jersey squad?
You know, they're very good. They have a really high skill level when you just look at their ability to do things like offload in the forwards, just crisp passing for their back line. They have probably the fastest hand speed in the league in terms of how fast they can get a ball from, you know, say a center field ruck. From the 9 to the 10, hands out to, you know, a wing on the outside. That's why their wings are so effective and why, you know, Naholo and Fido and Scudder and, you know, I mean, they got an embarrassing number of world-class wings. Mm-hmm. And what that's all about is they can get the ball to them so fast. They've always got space to work with. It makes them a really lethal attacking team. The signing controversy stuff, you know, this is not my area of interest, really. I mean, I'm very curious about it. I always like to know more details, but it's hard to get good information right now, right? About all this stuff. It's not like the NFL where everybody knows, you know, exactly how many dollars are on every contract and all mm-hmm. that. so my understanding is, you know, there's a salary cap, but there's also other roles that you can pay mm-hmm. someone to come and do. So you can have someone who is a player and draws X amount of salary as a player. Obviously, accommodations, every team, you know, the Free Jacks have been really good at getting players by providing good accommodations. They figured out that's something that's, you know, an effective tool for them to house guys together and make sure they're in a good area, that they're going to have fun and enjoy living in, all that sort of stuff.
Yes.
So accommodations, obviously, they're helping put people up in New York City. That's not part of the salary cap, but is, you know, considerable. If you have an offer of, you know, the same amount of money and will pay for you to live in yes. New York City, or the same amount of money and will pay for you to live in Houston, I'm going to go to New York City. I don't know about you guys. Maybe you really like, you know, Houston, but I'm going to go to New York. So that's a part of it. And then the other thing is that, you know, these guys sometimes they do a lot of coaching. They're paid to coach. I believe the Free Jacks do this as well, although I'm not sure. Guys have, you know, part player, part coaching roles. Mm-hmm. So all that together, you know, means there's a lot of mechanisms for teams to entice players to come play
yes.
that are outside of the former formal salary cap system and total. And that's kind of what the controversy is. There's loopholes you can drive a truck through right now. And that's, I think, kind of by design to give teams the leeway they need to you know, operate in a way that makes sense. You know, we'll see how it goes for New York this Friday and then this postseason. You know, yes. I think that because of the way talent and scouting and rugby work, it's not really a big problem. Like, it's kind of annoying, and I get being annoyed that teams seem to break rules. Mm-hmm. You know, whether they do or not, you know, the just the appearance of flaunting the salary cap. Obviously LA has been accused of the same thing. Mm-hmm. I understand not liking it. I think that it, you know, it did help LA last year. This year, some of those old guys are hurt. How much has Matt Gitto played? You know,
yep.
It's not really the best idea. So I just mean, like, kind of on a strategic level, it doesn't actually concern me that much. Not the fairness aspect, but like in terms of, are these guys going to be able to buy championships every year? Like, no, I don't think so. I don't think that the best path to the, you know, MLR Shield is through 35-year-old All Blacks.
I agree.
I just don't think that that's the most effective thing. I think it's cool that they're here playing.
Yes.
I don't mean to insult or talk down to those guys or about those guys at all. Right. I love that I'm going to get to watch that team play at Veterans Memorial Stadium and see these guys really rip it up. But I think competitively, you know, I'll take our team over them in a heartbeat.
Same. You know, it's cool that they're in the league, I guess. If the Free Jacks did this, I would kind of be like, yeah, of course I would talk about it and stuff like that. We would discuss it. But it really, first and foremost, it's off brand for the Free Jacks to do something like this. Our whole thing is, let's get some young kids in here that don't have opportunities in Super Rugby yet or stuff like that. And let's help them build their game. And obviously that process has worked. There's no doubt. All you have to do is look at 13 wins. It is a record-breaking win total this season for the Free Jacks with doing this. Our biggest signing is Dougie Fife.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and by the way, Dougie's a fantastic player, world famous rugby-wise, but he's not, you know, Chris Robshaw or, you know, whoever you want to, you know, name. And also, by the way, he's younger than those guys as well. So the Free Jacks are kind of mirror opposites to the teams that go about this type of, let's sign, you know, all-stars from 10 years ago or whatever.
Yeah.
And it's great that our team, you know, has that type of example that can show the rest of the league. You don't have to bring in these guys that are going to command big money. You can do it. And by building up your team with these guys that people really have never heard of in this country, and they can show themselves and prove that they're, you know, and polish their game and stuff like that here. And it can actually work. So that's one thing that I think that we as fans of the Free Jacks, you know, we're not making these big name signings and stuff like that. Well, we can just look and say, hey, scoreboard, man, like, it doesn't matter.
we're goose egg, as the boys were saying during the lineout kerfuffle with right. Nola.
Yeah,
goose egg up there for you guys.
Is all we need, and I've said that on social media when people are, you know, talking about or maybe worried or concerned with these signings that other teams are making. All we got is all we need. You know, trust the process that the Free Jacks have put into place with the guys that we have on our roster. We don't need some old, you know, has been. Not even has been. It's harsh to say that, but some older guys to come in and you know, make this team better when we already are good enough to win the Shield. As long as the ball bounces our way, we could win this thing. We're already in the playoffs. We've already got home field advantage. You know, so the proof is in the pudding already with what's in front of us. So yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. The other aspect of this is a rivalry game. Once again, you know, we're playing them three times this year. We've already played them twice. We've won the Chowder Cup, right? So it was a series. So that cup is staying in New England. Hopefully, I imagine that's going to be unveiled. I assume that will be the case at this game for the Free Jacks to hoist up at the end of the game, regardless of the scoreline. If New Jersey gets one over on us, we still have the overall series lead, you know, from the beginning of this thing, and we've won it this year as well. So that's one thing to keep in mind. I did want to mention announcement was made from the 1st Regiment that this is going to be a kilt up game, which I absolutely love that they're doing this. I think this comes from the New England Revolution, the soccer groups that do this. I believe it's at the end of every regular season game or the last game of the season, rather, they all put a tux on, those guys do. So that's their tradition of wearing tuxes to the last regular season game, I believe it is.
Got it. I'll have to ask my buddy Alex about that. Yeah.
So I'm glad that we're doing that in our own way here with the kilts. So make sure you guys wear your kilts, dust that bad boy off, and put it on prior to the game. And I did want to mention that there's an idea that Ranger Kenny threw around to me previously, and one of the Free Jack staffers actually brought up to me is when New Jersey comes trotting out onto the pitch, and I believe they announced their –
They do.
Okay. So when
the announcement is not always at the same time as the team comes out of the tunnel, but they do announce the roster.
So when the opposition team is being listed off for their starters and all of the players that are playing, we're going to have newspapers. So grab yourself a newspaper prior to the game and just be reading that as they're announcing the New Jersey players that are starting the game. So, so that's for this game. I did want to also make a mention of the Spider Appreciation Game on June the 19th. So our first playoff game, not this game against New Jersey, but the next game, whoever that opponent happens to be, we're going to have a Spider, the Superfan Spider Appreciation Day. So make sure you get your Daisy Dukes, your Tricorn hat, and your Continental Army t-shirt, which they do sell them on Amazon. There might be better places with faster shipping, but I did find them on there. So everybody dress up as Spider on June the 19th. So, yeah. In terms of this game, you know, we've already secured everything that we need to secure in terms of the playoff situation. We've got home field advantage regardless. So the question becomes, Dave, and I want to get your opinion on this, because I talked to a few of the Rangers there at the game, is what do you do if you're Scott Matthey? Do you play the kids? And when I say play the kids, I don't mean any disrespect to our players. What I'm talking about, it's like, it might be just a soccer term that I throw around. It's like, play the academy kids, you know, the development guys, let those guys start the game.
Focus on development.
Right. Focus on development. Let those kids come in, or players come into the game. And, you know, you don't have to worry about this. You don't have to win this game. Of course, it would be nice to, you know, have three wins against New Jersey, but it doesn't have to happen. There's no win for the Free Jacks here in terms of other than actually winning the game.
Yeah, there's nothing strategically to be gained in terms of the table.
Exactly.
There's no way that any team can finish with more points than us. So the results of this game from a competitive standpoint do not matter for the Free Jacks. They matter for New York in terms of whether they will host the 2-3 playoff or travel. They might rather travel. Maybe they'd rather go down to Atlanta than play on that high school field. But yes. You know, that they'll be playing for that. They'll be playing to try to be at home. For the Free Jacks, the thing is, I think it's tempting to work on development and rest injuries and, you know, let the guys who are going to be starting in the postseason get rest. But I really think that you have to balance that against preserving form and momentum.
Yes.
You want to be playing your best rugby as you go into the playoffs. Mm-hmm. We should be peaking in three weeks from now, about 2.5 weeks from when the episode drops.
Right.
And it's hard to peak 3 weeks from now if you're not playing rugby up until, you know, the end of the season, right? That's actually a really long break. If you imagine somebody, you know, say like they're like, oh, we're going to rest Bodine Waka. We don't need Bodine Waka. We're going to give him some time off. Well, it's going to be, you know, the June 3rd weekend, he won't play. And then we have a bye the weekend after that. You know, the June 10th weekend, he wouldn't play again until June 17th. And, you know, that's 3 full weeks of, you know, rest and no live rugby.
Yes.
So I really think that I think you will see a roster that is not 100% what you would expect from a playoff game. Guys who have injuries that we don't know about, you know, the stuff, the bumps and bruises, the guy whose foot got stomped on week 2 and it's not broken, it just hurts like hell every time he takes a step, that kind of stuff. Those guys will get some rest, I hope, right? They're the ones who could use an extra week of rest.
Yes.
guys who've been battling through week to week. But I don't think we'll see a full, you know, play it, let the boys play sort of approach. I think that you want to keep as much form and momentum as you can. And aside from, you know, a handful of guys, I think we'll have our best available team out there, and we will aim to make sure that if New York do win, it doesn't come easy, that they still are respecting us competitively. And I think psychologically it's important not, you know, you trot out a team that is not the best you have available. I mean, against a team like New York, you're really taking a risk. If we do that and they bring, have their heavy artillery, every all black they can, you know, drag out from under a carpet. If they do that, then there's a chance they beat the bag out of us, right? You know, they win, like we beat NOLA, they win by 40 points or something. And that's not, you know, from like a sports psychology standpoint, I mean, I'm no expert there, but I wouldn't want to be in that position going into a playoff match 2 weeks later, right? Yes. I wouldn't want to play them in the Eastern Conference Championship, assuming, you know, they beat Atlanta, whatever, and have just lost to them 2 weeks ago before our bye, and do not have gotten to play any rugby since then, right? That's what's critical, is to go from, we're going from this match against New York into the Eastern Conference Final.
Yeah.
So this is our last chance to tune things up and to make adjustments, and to make sure that we're fully prepared. So I think what we will see, a pretty competitive team. There is the room for the coaches to get a little weird, to make some adjustments. That can, there can be a little gamesmanship there too, like leave people guessing as to what exactly our roster is going to look like for that championship final.
Yeah, I mean, another thing to keep to consider is this: this is a New Jersey team that we could see in the playoff game. They could win their playoff game against Atlanta and face us in the Eastern Conference Finals. So, do you think it might merit doing some wacky stuff as you're talking about that would not be seen in the playoff game? Just do like throw some weird stuff, like like the lineout stuff. Just do some weird wacky stuff that I know that you love would love to do.
I mean, I would personally, I would field a competitive side, but I would give them a lot of freedom to make the tactical calls that they want to make. See some of those 10-man lineouts, you know, that they were doing. They had, you know, they had one against NOLA. We didn't really talk about it in our review, but there was one where they had both centers and a wing in that lineout. And they had a 10-man lineout. You know, I would encourage that. I think anything that keeps your opponent guessing is good. Obviously, you want to keep some weird stuff in reserve. You don't want to show your whole hand.
That's right.
I can't imagine there's a shortage of, you know, options and peels and strike plays and funny little things that they could throw out. I don't think they would be out of ammunition. I mean, that's something we talked about with Ryan Martin. One of the things last year was the coach. It was so noticeable about him was that the team came out and did something different every week.
That's right.
And the Free Jacks this season do as well. I think Scott Matthey has them changing it up week to week too. So this is just a part of what they do. But for Mardo, that was something that players talked about being a challenge, just the quantity of learning and, you know, reinventing things week to week, the expectation that was put on them to be able to shift and change things up. So that is all to say that there's no shortage of different weird things they could do, right?
Yes.
So I would hope that they get out with a very competitive team, that they maybe play with the game plan a little bit. Game plan is a thing you can adjust on the fly. You know, if they get a little funky, we're playing more than three phases, we're doing a lot of ball in hand rugby. You know, we're not, maybe we don't see the kick and chase that we saw so much, super effective against NOLA.
Yes.
Maybe we don't see a lot of that because they're going to hold that back a little bit and then bust back into that game plan for the game that counts. You know, a lot of what ifs, many things to watch. So I would just encourage fans to, you know, pay attention. And as you're watching the game, be thinking to yourself, is this what we were doing last week? are we playing the same way that we were playing? Are we doing things differently? Are we seeing more, fewer phases, you know, at a time when we have the ball? Are we kicking in the same way? Are we contesting every kick like we were? Or are we kicking deep for, you know, field position more? Stuff like that. Those are the things I'm curious to see, because, you know, that's what all the coaches will be watching in terms of preparation for the week after. So I'm curious, you know, myself, how all that stuff will be approached by the Matthew Rogers coaching team and what they're going to put out there in terms of game plan and look, and whether it's going to be the same, you know, don't mess with what works and we'll beat them that way on Friday and then we'll beat them again in 2 weeks if we have to, or if we see a little bit more gamesmanship. I honestly don't know. I don't know what to expect. So
yeah, it's going to be interesting because we don't know what roster will be filled in and stuff like that, what strategy was going to be implemented. But I did want to mention, I had asked a poll question to all over social media from the Jacks Rangers Show account here. So the question was, with a spot in the playoffs secured, are your expectations for the season, Matt? We've talked about this in previous episodes. For the Twitter, we've got 18 votes in total. 44% said hell yes, and 56% said hell no. That's just one that I had off the, you know, right in front of me there. So it kind of goes into what we're talking about here is, you know, the whole thing is, you know, we've gotten to the playoffs. So we can kind of play around with this game a little bit if we need to. Don't want injuries and don't want any cards in this game, especially like red cards and stuff like that, because that jeopardizes the future of the player playing in the playoff game. So with that being said, let's move over to key to the game. For me, I'll go first here. It all comes down, I was going to put play the kids in here, but I'm going to actually use that with what in my explanation. I'm just going to say roll the dice. So basically, you know, play the kids if you need to, mix up the lineup, maybe have the normal starters as finishers like we did in the Austin game, and you know, take chances that we normally wouldn't, change the strategy up a little bit, because this is essentially a throwaway game to a certain extent. The problem with, you know, resting and not having our starters in the lineup whatsoever is what you were talking about earlier, is rust. You don't want to have rusty players going into a playoff game. So, you know, have our normal starters on the bench, but let the younger development guys get a crack at this thing and see how it works out. I'll let you go next.
Yeah, mine is just leave our mark. The outcome of the game doesn't matter in terms of the standings, right?
Right.
So to me, what's most important is that if we, you know, win or lose, we give, we play a good game, we look good and clean, none of the, you know, desperate or just mistake-ridden kind of stuff we saw in Toronto, right? So
yes.
And none, you can't leave your mark if you can't hold on to the ball. So, you know, but what I mean by leave our mark is just give them something to remember us by. Even if they squeak out a win, make them dread coming back to Quincy 2 weeks later to come and play us. You know, it was it 2003 that Pedro Martinez said the favorite, the famous, you know, sometimes you have to just tip your hat and call him your daddy. You know, we want them to be ready. We've beaten them twice this season already. We're going to play them once, maybe twice more. And we want to leave that mark so that they're ready to tip their hat and just call us their daddy.
Absolutely. Yeah. Love it. I'll let you go first with predictions.
I do think it's going to be close. I think both teams will score a fair amount. I think they're a team that we have to beat by scoring a lot. Some teams we can beat by stopping them from scoring, and other teams we got to beat by scoring a lot because they're just going to score. I think that's one of them. So 32-27 is my prediction. I think we can come out on top, but I think there'll be a little bit of a tri-fest.
All right. For me, I've got New Jersey 28, New England 31. So I'm going for a higher scoring affair as well. I wonder if we do play our development guys, if we can put 31 on the board. I'm just going to say that I'm cautiously optimistic if that is the case. It all depends on that lineup. You know, we've talked about in the past that You know, this particular X game is going to be the most anticipated lineup that we see, but I think it's actually going to be this game truly to see what Scott Matthey does with the roster here for the 23. But yeah, that's going to wrap it up. Really excited to see everybody there at Fort Quincy. Don't forget your newspapers, and also don't forget your kilt. Once again, we are kilting up for this game. I know that we did it earlier in the season, but we'd like to keep the tradition alive of doing the last regular season game, wear that kilt. So excited to see everybody there. Make sure you're wearing your kilt and got your newspaper. And you got any final thoughts, Dave?
Let's rip. Let's get out to Veterans Memorial and have a great time. Looking forward to just a great atmosphere on Friday. I'm going to try to bring some work friends out. Everybody bring a buddy. Stands are fuller every week. Mm-hmm. I really think that we can probably sell the stadium out for a playoff match. So, you know, but it takes momentum, you know, bring people out this week so that they want to come for the championship. You know, they've been to a game already and they are hooked.
What is it when you're at like a dress rehearsal? Yeah, this is a dress rehearsal for the playoffs, guys. So obviously it doesn't matter what happens on the pitch for the Free Jacks. We've already, you know, cemented our legacy this year, if you will, with what we needed to do. But this is still our biggest rival. We don't want to, you know, just be silent like they are at their home field there at JFK Stadium. Make sure you're loud as hell. Make sure that they understand when the next, if they do happen to come back up this season and face off against us in the playoffs, they're going to be scared out of their wits. So make sure you're loud and proud, as you always are, Rangers and Continentals out there. And we will see you at the game in 3, 2, 1. Huzzah!
Huzzah!